Hey guys, we're going to go ahead and get started. Today, I have the distinct pleasure of introducing our next speaker, Kyle Reyes. Kyle is an entrepreneur, a Christian conservative, and a millennial. He is president and CEO of the Silent Partner Marketing Company, a boutique marketing agency headquartered in Connecticut, and national spokesman for Law Enforcement Today, a pro-law enforcement advocacy organization. In March of 2017, Reyes was featured on Fox News after his business drew publicity for including a snowflake test as a part of the job application process for new hires. Previously, Kyle was a producer of news and special projects, having worked in broadcast journalism for nearly a decade. His team at Silent Partner Marketing now offers a marketing one-stop shop, filling the role of a director of marketing and support staff at a fraction of the cost of having to worry about the payroll, taxes, benefits, equipment, and training. Reyes Agency manages the marketing programs for hundreds of companies across the United States, ranging from family-owned enterprises to multi-billion dollar corporations. His team designs and executes winning market strategies to help clients cut through the noise and connect directly with their consumer. Kyle is a proud and unapologetic conservative in the business world. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Kyle Reyes.
Thank you. What's going on, guys? Thanks for having me. That last guy was a much better speaker than me, so don't get your hopes up on this, but I figured I'd try and get you pumped up with a little video to start, so let's do this. Oh, wait, no sound. Hang on. No sound. Sorry. Well, while you work on that, I'm going to give you guys a little bit of context. Oh. Snowflakes are a mentality, not a political mindset. It's not about who you voted for, whether you're on the left or the right. It's about whether or not you have the hustle and the drive and are willing to work for a living.
I wanted to be able to have individuals work for my company who would sort of fit the culture.
This test immediately weeded out 60% of people who, as soon as they saw the word test, freaked out and dropped out of the process.
I can see lawsuits. I guarantee that somebody's going to sue you. Many people are going to sue you saying, wait, that's illegal discrimination.
That's great. I appreciate you putting that idea in their heads, but there's no discrimination here because all that this really is a glorified personality test.
All right, so what's the ultimate outcome for you?
The ultimate outcome is that we find some high-quality employees who fit the culture and mindset of our company and our clients.
Well, everybody seems to think that entrepreneurship and running businesses is all glitz and glamour, and it's not.
It was a dream of mine to own my own business and become an entrepreneur and be my own boss.
Entrepreneurship to me means developing a great brand.
At the end of the day, we do a lot more than bottle openers. What we really specialize in is gifts that are over the top.
These plants, they're in their purest form. It's medicine in its purest form. And this is actually more built into us as humans than single molecules.
There's nothing fancy in a firefight. It's hands on, game on.
Bad day is truly a catastrophic event in your life. You know, most people's idea of a bad day is nothing. It's merely a detour in how you thought your day was going to unfold.
Okay, so we're not talking about racism, we're talking about reinforcing narrative.
That's what I said. It reinforces the narrative of the left.
I have a problem with the Clinton Foundation laundering $300 million in sort of rebuilding the country.
Right.
Why can't someone talk about that? That is racism.
Let's talk about policy. Let's talk about policies that can move this country forward and once again help the veterans, but actually help the middle class and Americans get jobs and seek happiness.
All right, so today we're going to go on a little bit of a journey, and I want you guys to feel free to just jump in and ask questions at any point. I'm not structuring this as a big formal lecture. I want to give you guys insight about the world of business and the world of failure, because regardless of how many people tell you that everything in life is sunshine and bubbles and double-stuffed Oreo cookies, it's not. So a little bit of context. We're going to talk a little bit about the Whiskey Patriots at the end, which is that logo you saw there, but I am not here today speaking as a member of the silent majority, regardless of what you may have been told. I'm here as a member of the very vocal minority. I'm here as a member of the business owners who don't really give a damn what society says you have to stand for and what you can and can't say and what you have to believe in. So let me give some backstory, because I wasn't handed a business. I was very blessed to grow the business from scratch, but let's go all the way back to the beginning. So as you saw in the pictures in the beginning, I was the fat kid growing up. There are all these anti-bullying programs out there right now. I think that's all well and good, but I'm also a big believer that you develop a thick skin by taking the punches that life has to give you. And so growing up, my family weren't wealthy. We were just the opposite. I remember having government peanut butter. I obviously ate a tremendous amount of peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. But I always had that entrepreneurial bug. I was recently told a story about how I was 4 years old and my mother was working at a place that was she was a veterinary technician. And we would hang out there in the summertime. And apparently I went up to the vet who owned the place, to his wife, and said, "Mrs. Luer, I'd like to make some money." And she said, "Well, I don't," and again, I have no memory of this. She said, "I don't have any jobs for you." I said, "Well, I notice you have a lot of rocks on your front lawn. How about I pick them all up for you and you pay me for that?" And she said, "Okay, how about I give you a penny a rock?" And apparently my response was, "Why don't we talk about a price based on weight?" Like, I have no idea where I came up with this stuff. Second grade, I went to Catholic school, and we had typing class. Now, this was back before your time. We had Apple IIe computers, and we would go underneath the convent, and Sister Gertrude, we would have our typing class. And if you finished typing class, you got to play a game called the lemonade stand. Now, the lemonade stand was super cool. I see a couple of you nodding like you know what it is. You would basically do this. You would pick out how many lemons you wanted to buy, how many cups, how much sugar, based on what the forecast was for the next day, and based on how much the price of the lemons, the sugar, and the cups were. And then you would set the price that you wanted to charge for lemonade, and then based on the weather and what the market did, would determine how much money you made. That right there were sort of the roots of entrepreneurism for me. Now, I'd like to make you all think that I was some great savant. I wasn't. I was also the same kid who I was running late for the bus one day, still second grade, still Sister Gertrude, and apparently I realized it was my day for show and tell. And again, I don't really have much of a memory of this, but apparently when it came time for show and tell, Sister Gertrude said, "Okay, Kyle, what did you bring for show and tell?" And I unzipped the pencil case and I pulled out my mother's bra. I don't know what I was thinking, don't ask. I do remember Sister Gertrude picking me up in the desk and carrying me to the principal's office. So again, this isn't a story about some savant. This is a story about a kid who hustled his face off. So moving along, when I was 13 years old, my family moved from New Jersey to Massachusetts. I went from private school to public school, and it was a pretty rude awakening for me. I didn't know anybody. I didn't make friends very quickly, but I learned, again, how to sort of develop that thick skin. So I was pushed around, I was beat up. I have a memory of the day that all of that real bullying ended for me. So my sophomore year, my best friend passed away unexpectedly. She contracted bacterial meningitis, and she died. And I was in the play Grease. And it was the day after the funeral, and we were behind the band room, and there was this kid, and he was just running his mouth because a couple of kids were crying because she had passed away. And he said, "I don't know what's wrong with these people. They need to just get over it and move on. She's dead." And so he had sort of his back was against the wall, and I went up to him and I said, "What did you say?" And he said, "I said, you people need to get over it, including you, you 500-pound blimp." Now, I was not a fighter at all, but that day, I was. And I was in a really dark place, and I hit him in the face, which was the first time I had ever punched anybody in my life. I think it was actually the last time. Like I said, I'm not much of a fighter. Well, here's what a dark place I was in at that point. When I hit him, his head hit the wall, and he got knocked out. But I was in a dark place, and I thought I killed him. So I did what I think anybody would have done in that situation. I dragged his body into the band closet, and I covered him in trombones and saxophones, and then I went back into the play, into rehearsal. So he came out about an hour later, and it was like I had just seen Jesus rise, you know? And a couple days later, he asked me, he didn't report me, didn't say a word. I think he was scared of me. I think I was scared of myself at that point, because I had all of a sudden just become a killer. And he said, "What were you thinking? I woke up in the band closet." I said, "Oh, I thought you were dead." And after that, I must have had a reputation or something, because nobody messed with me. Senior year in high school, I did an internship at 22 News. They made sure that you pronounced it 22 News. It was the local NBC affiliate. I learned all about how to run a teleprompter, how to run cameras, and I guess I was a pretty ballsy kid, because when I graduated, I went up to the news director that summer and I said, "You're gonna hire me." And he started laughing at me. He goes, "I don't hire college students." I said, "Well, you're lucky. I'm not a college student yet. I start in the fall." Long story short, I went to a local college. I worked 40 hours a week at that TV station. And then my sophomore year in college, I was recruited by the competition. They said, "Listen, we have a position open. We know we're not supposed to be talking to you, but we have a position available for you here. We'd like you to produce the 6 and the 11 o'clock news." I said, "That's cool, but I'm still in college." They said, "Can you make it work with your schedule?" So I thought that the salary that they offered was just mind-blowing at the time. I was paying my way through school. I was making $19,000 a year. It was huge money. So I would have class from 7 in the morning until 3 in the afternoon, and then I would drive to the TV station, and I would produce a 6 and the 11 o'clock news. I would get out of there at 11:30, right after my show, and I would go run bar promos, because I was the assistant marketing manager for a company called Team Enterprise. We did all the marketing locally for Bombay Sapphire, Grey Goose, DiSerrano, Bacardi. Now, the irony of this is that in my newscast, I was reporting on the Springfield mob. And these guys, a lot of them had just gotten out on federal racketeering charges. And then that night, I would be in their bars that they owned and ran, running bar promos. So we would have, you know, half dozen Bacardi girls or whatever the situation was, and I'd be overseeing them. But I was very transparent with the owners early on, because the last thing that I wanted to do was end up at the bottom of the Connecticut River. So I went up to them and I said, "Listen, I just, in full transparency, I am a producer. I go to school full time. I'm paying my way through school. I don't want you to think I'm here for anything other than trying to pay my way through." And the first time that I had that conversation with a guy who I think is now serving life behind bars, he stared me down and he said, "Why did you just tell me that?" I said, "Honestly, because I don't really want to die, and I wasn't sure any other way of approaching this." And he stared at me for a second and he goes, "That took some balls, kid." And that was the end of the conversation. 2 days later, I got an anonymous phone call about a raid that was happening on what turned out to be their competitors. And these guys started leaking the information. And then my career in journalism started blowing up. I graduated from school. I was about to sign a contract at a TV station in Edison, New Jersey. I got a phone call from NBC. They owned and operated at that point 10 stations, including one in Connecticut. They offered me a job. I went there, and I became indoctrinated with the liberal agenda about how the media should work. I was told that the term black ice is racist and we shouldn't use it. I was told that the term Black Friday is racist, and what else you call Black Friday, I have no freaking idea to this day, but apparently you weren't allowed to say that. I learned all about privilege, and a lot of this stuff, it was interesting because I learned a lot of this stuff in college too, but I never really processed it, and honestly, it wasn't even until I got into the world of business that I realized what had been happening in college and what had been happening in TV, where I was told that you can't say illegal alien. It's undocumented migrant now. And so the narrative was starting to change, and I had no idea what was happening because I was living in that world. And so first of all, I gotta give you guys big ups, because I am so excited to see you all here taking this country by storm and taking it over and fixing things on that local level. I think it's absolutely incredible. And can I have you guys all give yourselves a round of applause for a second here, because that's seriously badass, guys. Growing up, I learned that little Johnny was always given everything. Little Johnny was told, "Listen, you can be anything you want in this world. anything. But little Johnny ate glue sticks until the sixth grade, right? And little Johnny was that kid who, when I went into the bathroom, he would drop his pants around his ankles to pee at the urinal. But we were told that little Johnny could be absolutely anything. And here's the problem with that. We have set these false expectations in life. We have said, little Johnny, you can be the president. You can be a rocket scientist. And little Johnny wasn't going to be the president or the rocket scientist. But what happened? Little Johnny has spent his entire life trying to get to that level and now suffers from depression and anxiety because he feels like he failed his parents and he feels like he wasn't good enough. What we should be saying to kids these days is, listen, it's okay to be a tradesman. It's okay to be a carpenter. It's okay to be a plumber. And I'll tell you what, when you guys start having to hire plumbers, you're going to realize that you will make a fortune as a plumber, because I think we just spent like $500 for a 15-minute pipe fix, but that's a whole other conversation. We're not telling kids that it's okay to do you. When I was in college, my father said to me, listen, get that degree. I was miserable in school, guys. I was working full time. I was learning more in the industry than I was learning in school. And my dad and my mom said to me, just get that piece of paper, just get through it, and the world is your oyster. And I didn't really understand that whole idea of the world is your oyster. But what I realize now is what they meant was you really can do anything if you've got the hustle and the drive to do it. So I ended up taking a buyout package from TV, and I got a 17-week severance package. I got some tuition reimbursement. I got all my vacation time. And it was great because I was working 80 to 100 hours a week on salary at that point. I was miserable. Overnights, early mornings, late nights, flip around, do the same thing all over again. Guys, I would call OnStar on the drive home and ask them to tell me jokes to keep me awake so I wouldn't fall asleep behind the wheel. Swear to God, it was rough. We got to meet some incredible people. I interviewed Bill Clinton. I interviewed Miss America, Bill Cosby before he was doing the pudding roofie thing. Got to meet some really cool people. Didn't appreciate it at that point. Did not appreciate the people that I got to meet because I was so exhausted. So I took the buyout package the first day. I slept. Slept the entire day. It was awesome. Second day, cleaned my townhouse. Third day, went to the gym. Fourth day, I'm like, what the hell am I going to do with the rest of my life? I have absolutely no idea. I knew how to market. I knew how to storytell. I knew I wanted to own a business. I had no idea what that was going to look like. So while I was trying to figure it out and put it together, this was back in 2008, while I was trying to figure it out, my neighbor said, hey, listen, why don't you apply to bartend at this nice Italian restaurant that I'm a server at, and you can figure it out. You can make some cash on the side. You won't have to worry about money. So I said, all right. So I went in there, and I'm interviewing for the position, and they said, wait a minute, you can write a press release? Yeah, I can write a press release. I was the gatekeeper for the last 8 years in the media. They were like, well, we're actually hiring a director of communications and marketing. Are you interested? I said, yeah, but can I still bartend? They said, well, we look for about 3 years experience. Do you have about that? And I said, about that, meaning like we should probably talk about that because I've never actually made a drink professionally, but they took it as I had about 3 years experience. So they hired me. And the first day was an absolute catastrophe because I was thrown right in during a Friday happy hour, which if anyone's ever been to Friday happy hour, you know how crazy it is. And the girl who was training me to replace her said, all right, I need a margarita and a martini for those two girls over there. And I'm like looking around hoping there's a book to teach me how to make a margarita and a martini. And she realized pretty quickly that I had no business bartending whatsoever. So she was like, oh my God, you don't know how to make a margarita or a martini. I'm like, it'll be fine, don't worry. So I went up to the girls who were at the bar. I was like, did you guys just order a margarita and a martini? They're like, yeah. I'm like, that's not what you want. And they're like, oh, what do we want? And I'm like, I got you. So I turn around behind the bar, I start throwing a whole bunch of stuff in, I shake it up, I poured it. They're like, what is it? I'm like, just put it in your mouth, you guys are gonna love it. They tried it, they were like, oh my God, it's so good. And I was like, I've got this bartending thing down. 5 minutes later, they're like, can we get another round of the same thing? And I'm like, I have no idea what I put in this. So I'm like, no, guys, I actually have something that you're gonna like even better. And it was in that moment when I completely duped everybody into believing that I was a great bartender that I realized that sometimes taste and preference are simply a measure of the best marketing. And the light bulb went off, and I knew that marketing was going to be my steez full time. So I started growing the business. I started making mistakes. This isn't like an instant success story like, oh, all of a sudden I had OtterBox as a client. Nope, we had to build to that point with mistake after mistake after mistake and trusting my gut. So I had this firm that I was working with while I was running the bar and while I was running their marketing, and they were paying me a really good chunk of change. And then I started getting a really bad feeling about it. Couldn't put my finger on it, had no explanation, just something didn't feel right. And so I cut ties with them. I ended it. And at the time, everybody thought I was crazy. Like, why would you end that? I said, I don't know, it just didn't feel right. They were like, you just walked away from all that money for no good reason. Now, in a perfect world, I'd tell you guys that a day later, all this bad stuff happened. No, but 2 years later, what happened was the owner of that company was arrested on 6 federal grand jury indictments for money laundering and embezzling and all this other stuff. So my simple lesson to you guys there is trust your gut. Every single time. If I had trusted my head, I probably would have had my name associated with him. I would have kept taking that money. I trusted my gut. I got out and I won. I was offered a position shortly after that as the director of advertising, marketing, and public relations for an automotive group. I took the position on the contingency that I could still sling drinks on Thursday and Friday nights because I loved it and I had actually gotten really good at it by that point. And I also said to the owner, listen, I still want to keep growing my business. And he said, well, if that's a conflict with our group, it's going to be a problem. I said, I'll grow it to the point where it's a conflict and then I'll leave. And so we struck a deal. It worked out well. I got married to the love of my life back there in 2013. The day that we closed on our house was the day that I put in my notice. And he was really pissed about that because he knew that I was just holding on long enough to be able to get the mortgage. And then it was game on. The moment that my company transformed from me doing it really well to the company exploding was when I started hiring people who were a lot smarter than me. The biggest takeaway that I hope you guys have from all of this is that if you are the smartest person in the room, guys, you're in the wrong room. Always surround yourself with men and women who are smarter than you, and you will always win. Because if you are the smartest person in the room, there's no incentive to level up. And if you guys are constantly leveling up by surrounding yourselves with people who are smarter than you, you're always going to win. So the agency blew up, and then about 2 years ago, maybe you guys will remember this story nationally, Hampshire College up in Massachusetts, the students took down the American flag, and on Veterans Day, they burned the American flag. And then the college said, we're not putting the American flag back up because it triggers students. And I lost it. Absolutely lost it. So I'm driving into work and I called up one of my guys and it was actually his first day. I'm like, Devon, get the camera ready. We're filming as soon as I get there. And he sounded like all out of it. He was like, well, what time are you going to be there? I'm like, I'm going to be there in half an hour. And he's not responding. I'm like, what's the matter? He's like, oh, it's 5 o'clock in the morning. I was like, oh, I'm sorry. Just get there when you can. He got in. I got there. We filmed this video and we called out these college students. I had a buddy of mine who was blown up in Afghanistan. It's a miracle that he survived. He joined me for it. And I basically said, listen, our company is everything that your gender studies professor told you you would find in the workplace when you graduate college in, I don't know, 8 or 10 years. And guess what? Even we're not going to hire you. And addressed the fact that these students have this entitled mentality and don't know what it's really like to make it in the real world. Didn't expect that video to blow up like it did. But we got more than 5 million views in something like 28 hours. And next thing I knew, we were inundated with job applicants, which was great because we were going through that big growth spurt at the time. So we started having people come in. Now, in the video, we showed that we have 8-foot beanbag chairs and a 25-foot bar and an office dog and an Xbox and a caterer and a personal trainer for employees. And so we start going through this interview process. And people are coming in, and the very first one, this girl sits across from me. I ask her a couple of high-level questions, and I said, where do you see yourself in 3 years? And she's like, oh, God, I don't even know where I see myself in 6 months. And I'm like, can't you lie to me? Like, try and make me feel good about this. I said, well, why'd you apply with our company? She said, well, I don't know. You guys have a cool bar. And I'm like, what do you want to do with our company? She's like, I don't know. And I'm like, oh, my God. And this was happening again and again. So I realized that we needed a way to vet out lousy applicants. Enter the snowflake test. 30 questions, short answer, essay style. What does America mean to you? How do you feel about guns? How do you feel about the police? You see someone stomping on an American flag, what happens next? The one that really upset a lot of people was, when was the last time you cried and why? you're sitting in Starbucks and someone runs in and hands you a gun and says in 30 seconds someone's going to run in and start shooting. What happens next? That's a trick question. All Americans shouldn't be drinking in Starbucks, but that's, you know. So the test started weeding people out, and then the media found out about it the day a blizzard hit Connecticut, and the media went nuts. So next thing you know, it was actually the day before I was going on a business trip to Savannah. So I'm doing Fox and Friends first, Varney and Company, Risk and Reward, The Kennedy Show, Louder with Crowder. We ended up getting $23 million in free media exposure in a week. And that's not even including the replays, all the social media engagement, any of that. 40,000 emails. We were not set up to handle 40,000 emails. 10,000 job applicants, and overwhelmingly positive exposure. So now flash forward. So the company keeps growing. Last year we made 10,000 videos for clients. And the year before that, we did a video with the Manchester, Connecticut Police and Fire Departments. We brought them together. We did this really cool video about emergency responders. Video got about 3 million views. We got the chiefs on Fox and Friends. And when they were on Fox and Friends, Ainsley Earnhardt said, "Who made this video for you guys?" And they said, "Well, the Silent Partner Marketing is donating $500,000 in services. It's pledged, you know, 500 grand in services to tell the stories behind the uniforms of men and women." Now, when that hit Fox and Friends, you would think that that would be overwhelmingly positive, right? Everybody's talking all about our agency and what we've done at this point and this big donation. Well, what ended up happening was in just a few minutes, we started getting inundated with fake one-star reviews from people who were saying, "You need to shut down this campaign because you're supporting pigs and killers and Nazis." And so we started getting, between that and the snowflake test, we started getting hundreds of one-star reviews. Now, you guys all know what happens in the world of Yelp and Google reviews and Facebook reviews when you're getting one-star reviews. It has a really negative impact on business. So my management team is getting really nervous about this. They say, "Kyle, what are we gonna do?" I said, "Well, we only have one choice at this point." They said, "Kill the campaign?" I said, "No, we're gonna double the campaign, and they could kiss our American asses if they have a problem with that." We did, the media went nuts, so did Antifa and all of these other clowns. But it doesn't matter, because guys, when you double down on who you are and what you believe in and your values as men and women who are patriotic Americans, the net gain is you will always win every single time. And so we started having some of the most patriotic companies in the world come out and say, "What do you guys do? You run marketing? We're in." And so we ended up picking up a tremendous amount of business. We got fired by a couple of clients, don't get me wrong, because they didn't want to be associated with it. Now, you heard in the beginning, the name of my agency is The Silent Partner Marketing. It's The Silent Partner for a reason. We run the marketing for our clients silently in most cases. You would never know the companies that we handle the marketing for. And this really became prevalent during that time, during that negative media exposure, because we were able to take these super patriotic companies and say, "Listen, we could operate your marketing silently, or we can be public about it. It's up to you." A lot of our clients choose to leverage our audience and all of that exposure. We have companies like you saw in there, Bottle Breacher, which is a retired Navy SEAL, turns 50 cal bullets into bottle openers. So we've got some really cool companies like that. But the whole idea is that when you double down on your values, it doesn't matter what those values are. If you're conservative, if you're Christian, it doesn't matter. Double down on them, own it, and you will always win. I'm sitting around one day with Mike Monaco. Now, Mike is a Marine. He did a couple tours overseas. And we're sitting around and we're sipping on bourbon and we're talking about the toxicity of manliness. I'm sure you guys have heard about it on your campuses, right? It's not acceptable to be a man. Women don't like manly men anymore. Being a man is evil. It's sexist and racist and homophobic and Islamophobic and all the phobias. And so we're sitting around drinking whiskey, and he said, I wish we could do something about this. I said, "Yeah, we can." He said, "What are we gonna do?" I said, "We're gonna do the Real Man Show." And so we're joking about it. He said, "No, the Man Show already exists." I said, "No, that's Jimmy Kimmel. Dude, come on, Jimmy Kimmel's not a real man. So let's do the Real Man Show." And he said, "Well, what do you have in mind?" I said, "We're just gonna resurrect the art of manliness. We're gonna do manly stuff, and we're gonna have fun with it." And he's thinking about it. I said, "Listen, think about it like this. We get to write off doing man stuff on our taxes. And we get an excuse when we say to our wives, listen, we have to go across the country to do man vacations. The truth comes out, honey. So we start doing the show just sort of as a joke, and guys, it exploded. First episode, in like 6 hours, we've got 250,000 views on it. We have hundreds of people messaging us saying, come here, do this, do this. And then we start using the data from the show, and now they're selling all these trucks. And we realized that there was a tremendous hunger for all of this art of manliness. So to this day, we've done everything from learning how to shoot a 50 cal and learning how to do sniper shooting to as you saw, we were in a helicopter in the middle of Texas shooting pigs in the middle of the night. We did Survival Systems USA, so we got strapped into the fuselage of a helicopter, submerged underwater, flipped upside down, and taught how to escape underwater. We were just in Texas for another episode, which, by the way, guys, and this really goes back to, I want you to keep some perspective on something. Every one of you right now is in sort of your own little microcosm of this country. But do we have anyone from the Northeast? Show of hands. Where in the Northeast? I'm so sorry, the People's Republic, welcome. Neither do we. Where are you from?
Connecticut.
All right, and where in Connecticut are you guys from?
New Haven.
Okay, cool. So Connecticut and Utah and Texas are, it's like we're totally different countries. It's crazy. And we're in Texas a couple of weeks ago, and we're filming this event. We're filming an episode of The Real Man Show, and we're filming this event for wounded police officers. And we left there, and we had about an hour. We were ATV riding, so we're filthy. And we were doing some shooting, and we had about an hour before this really fancy dinner, so we didn't have time to go shower and get cleaned up. So I said to the guy running the event, I said, is there like a Walmart around here so we go get baby wipes and get cleaned up? And he goes, nah, but we got Fred's. I'm like, all right, cool, Fred's it is. Where's Fred's? So he tells me, so we're driving down the road. We're in a brand new suburban, tinted windows. Back roads in Texas are like 75 miles everywhere, so I'm not paying attention to the speed, and then I see an unmarked cruiser on the side of the road. And then I'm paying attention to the speed. I look at the speed limit sign, I look down, I'm like, I'm screwed. So we keep going. About a half mile later, I see the cruiser pull out behind us, no lights or anything. Another half mile, I pull into Fred's, we all get out, cruiser pulls up next to me, rolls down his windows. Good afternoon, son. So, good afternoon, officer. He goes, where are y'all from? I said, we're from the People's Republic of Connecticut. He says, now I'm wearing my Trump shirt and everything. He says, what are y'all doing out here? So I said, we're here filming this event for wounded officers. He goes, 78 in a 4-5 for Fred's. I ain't never seen that before. And I'm like, officer, I am so sorry. I'm an idiot. I don't know this area at all. You know, please forgive me. He goes, 78 for Fred's. Well, I can't wait to tell the boys about that. Y'all have a good day now here. And I'm like, wait a minute. You're not like arresting me? You're arresting you. Welcome to Texas. Have a good day. And I think it's so important. We all get so caught up where we live. And we like to build this concept of what America looks like based on what we know and the people we surround ourselves with. Guys, in the last month, I've traveled from Vernal, Utah, which is the middle of nowhere, like the middle of nowhere, to we did Orlando, St. Augustine, Colorado, Wyoming, New York, New Mexico, Boston, West Palm Beach, Texas, Orlando, Virginia now. And what I've learned in just the last month and a half of traveling is that even though we are one country and we are one people, we have a whole totally, totally different world that we live in. People in Connecticut and New York talk about how there's never going to be a need for AR-15s. And yet you tell that to someone in Utah who the closest police response is 45 minutes away. And so I encourage you all, as you go back onto your campuses and as you're told these stories by your professors about what the world and what America looks like, to remember that their America may be very, very different from the America that another American knows and respects. And so I want to, and at any point you guys, because I know we're tight on time, can feel free to jump up, and all questions are fair game in this. But we moved on to, we've started this new company, this new movement, and it's called the Whiskey Patriots. And the idea behind the Whiskey Patriots is that when our founding fathers were drafting the Constitution, they didn't have easy access to clean drinking water, and so they sipped whiskey. So the name of the Whiskey Patriots is a tribute to the founding principles of our country. You stand behind our veterans, our emergency responders. You want an America that's even better than the America that we've always known. then you're a whiskey patriot. So we did a soft launch of the platform on the 4th of July. It was the day that we declared our independence from the shackles of what the mainstream media has told us we have to say and think and believe. And we've had thousands of people sign up, and we haven't even done the formal launch on this yet. And we are having chapters in every single state rise up. So we have commitments in 47 states now for chapters of the Whiskey Patriots. And the real message that I hope you guys all take away today is that you will never just be handed something and someone's going to tell you, this is your business, here's millions of dollars. You have to earn that. You have to grow that. Your professors are going to tell you, you can be anything that you want in this world. Sure, you can be if you work your faces off, if you hustle harder than everybody else. And you'll hear people all the time tell you about their successes in business, about how great they are, about how we have this wonderful multi-million dollar agency. But guys, I'm here to tell you that you are going to fail. You're going to fail in life, and that's okay. Rarely do speakers get up there and stand in front of you and say, guys, you're gonna screw up. Guys, I screwed up so many times, it's not even funny. I sat down with this guy, this was about 5 years ago, and he said, I'm looking for someone, we're a startup beer company, and I want someone to run our marketing. I said, can I try your beer? So I tried his beer, and he was like, what do you think? Can you guys handle our marketing? I said, well, yeah, we could handle your marketing, but I'm not interested, I appreciate it. He said, what do you mean you're not interested? I said, I don't like your beer. The look on the, you would think that I just like told him he had an ugly kid. Right? So he was like, we have the best beer in the world. I'm like, cool, I'm sure there are people who think that, but I just don't like it, and I'm not gonna put my name on something that I don't believe in. He was so upset, he was so offended, so we passed on the opportunity. Today, it's one of the biggest beer companies in the Northeast. So, and the beer's gotten a lot better, thank God for them. But the point is that you are going to face failures. You're going to make mistakes. The test of a true entrepreneur isn't whether or not you win or lose, whether or not you pass or fail. It's the ability to get up off of your butt when you get knocked down and work harder than everybody else. The true test is, can you stand up and rise and fight back more than the guy next to you who failed and didn't get back up? Entrepreneurship isn't about winning, it's about hustling. Entrepreneurship isn't about making millions of dollars, it's about making your own life. It's about forging your own path. It's about your own journey. And so, as you guys all go back to your campuses and start classes again in September or August or whenever it is these days, and in each of your respective regions of the country, I want you to remember that entrepreneurship and the silent majority do go hand in hand. Did anyone see the movie Rocky III? So I was just watching Rocky III again recently, and it occurred to me, for if you haven't seen this movie, Apollo Creed, Sylvester Stallone, Rocky, Apollo Creed is his boy, and he gets literally killed in a fight. And so Sylvester Stallone, Rocky, gets up there, and in the next scene after the funeral, he says, I'm gonna go take out the Russian who killed him, like take him out in a fight. He's going to sort of redeem the story. And so they're having this press conference where Drago, the Russian, and Rocky, Sylvester Stallone, are, you know, sitting near each other. And the two managers for Drago and Rocky start getting into it. And the guy says, you know, we're gonna have this match in the Soviet Union because your country is violent. He says, our country is violent. He goes, please, man, your country keeps people behind a wall with freaking machine guns. And he said, who do you think you are, says to the American. And he says, me? I'm the silent majority. And I'm like, they started back with Rocky. And it did. So President Trump was actually a huge Sylvester Stallone fan and a personal friend of his. So between Rocky and Kennedy, Kennedy also talked about the silent majority. But the idea of the silent majority is that we sit here quietly doing our thing, building our businesses, paying tribute to the founding values and principles of our country, fighting for what's right, standing behind our emergency responders, standing behind our veterans, fighting for the principles that made this country great, but we do it quietly. We do it silently. And when we vote and when we implement change, we do it en masse. Guys, I don't want you to be a member of the silent majority anymore. It's because we are the silent majority that we are getting our butts handed to us across this country. We're the silent majority because we're not the ones who are yelling and vocal and donning these big hats and marching in parades and making a big stink about it on social media. But why? Why shouldn't we be the ones? We went into a store today and there was a kid's book by Hillary Clinton and a kid's book about Ruth Ginsburg. The indoctrination is starting so young, and we're just sitting here going, well, we want to do the right thing. We want to play nice. We don't want to fight. We don't want to yell. We don't want to scream. We don't have a choice. You guys see what's happening on your campuses. You see these tremendous speakers being told to shut up and being told to get out of campus. You see violence and shouting and screaming, shutting down conservative voices because the left believes in the First Amendment as long as they hear things that they want to hear. And if they don't, they will do everything in their power to shut you down and shut you up. The problem is that we've been the silent majority for too long, and you guys are in a prime position to begin changing that. You're in a prime position because it's assumed that because you guys are college students, that you're all liberal. You're all Democrats. You guys have actually infiltrated college campuses, and this is a tremendous opportunity for you to stand up and begin to fight. And I just hope that you guys all take away from this experience in this couple of days that when you stand up and fight, you may get knocked down once or twice or 10 times or 20 times. It's not a question of if and when you get knocked down. It's a question of whether or not you're willing to stand up and fight harder than everybody else. Guys, thank you for having me. Any questions? Yeah. I went to Westfield State.
Okay.
It was Westfield State College, now it's Westfield State University, so I never really know how to answer that.
It's about half an hour from my house.
Awesome. Small world. And a couple of Connecticut natives. Yeah. I'm a big fan of Jefferson's Aged at Sea. It's spectacular. I thought it was a marketing ploy, and they put it in oak barrels, and it touches all seven continents. So I was like, oh, yeah, that's a big marketing play. But less contact with the oak, and it takes the brininess of the ocean. It is. Yes. It touches them all. It goes in a cargo carrier. Why? I have no idea, but it's delightful. No, that's ridiculous. If you're arrested for a DUI or you're a pedophile, that's really bad publicity, and that's not good. That's not good at all. And regardless of, you know, you'll hear that all the time. You usually hear that from people who had some bad stuff happen to them, and they were like, oh, bad publicity is good. No, bad publicity can suck. Good publicity is good. Now, if you get bad publicity from, like, CNN, and it's for being a conservative and standing up, that's good publicity if you're willing to double down on it. State of Connecticut has more than 700,000 registered businesses. We do business nationally. I don't want 0.01% of all of those businesses as clients. So that means at scale, I can technically take off 99.999% of all business owners and we're still crushing it. So it's all about context, but try not to do really bad stuff because that's not the kind of publicity you want.
Thank you so much. That's all the questions we have time for. Let's give another round of applause for our speaker.